Hello? Hi? Hello, are Hello. We live? I hope we're live.
I hope so.
Hey, Anthony, how are you?
There's a lot of little Postman people. I'm doing good. How are you?
Good. Welcome to the live stream, everyone. My name is Joyce. I'm a developer advocate with Postman, and I'm based here in San Francisco. Anthony, you want to introduce yourself?
Yeah, my name is Anthony Dombrowski. I'm a developer advocate at Ping Identity, and I'm here in Austin, Texas.
Yeah, I think I met you maybe like a year ago or maybe more. Postman had did a meetup in Austin. I think it was our first Austin meetup. And weren't you there?
I was there. Yeah, the your CTO was there too, and a couple other people. So that was really cool.
Yeah,
hope you do it again sometime.
Ankit came down for that meetup. There was like some API conference going on, and a bunch of Postman people came down, and just a real warm welcome from the Austin folks.
Yeah, I was starting my developer advocacy career too, so I was bugging you about a bunch of questions.
I remember you were such a pest. Just kidding. Just kidding. So welcome. You work at Ping, and we've done some things with your company in the past as well. Just tell us what your company does really quick.
Yeah, we're an identity access management company. So when you register or log in or manage your profile, kind of all the security and the try to help with the user experience, all that stuff, the identity stuff that sits behind the scenes is what our company does.
Yeah. So today we're going to dive into OAuth 2.0. Is that correct?
Yep, that's right.
Okay, because that's the only one that I Googled, like, what is OAuth 2.0? So hopefully. Yeah,
OAuth 1.0 has been, you know, sunset a long time ago, and it's not secure, so you really shouldn't be using it.
I feel like I have seen some companies use like some flavor of OAuth 1 still. I mean, they're still using it, right?
It's probably, yeah, legacy carried over from, you know, a long time ago, because OAuth 2.0 has been out for like 10 plus years now too.
Yeah. Well, you know, people are always behind the times. I think I got called out for having Python 2, and I was like, yeah, I've heard they're deprecating it. And people were like, yeah, it was like a decade ago. I missed the memo.
You gotta move on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so I have a lot of windows open right now, so I don't want to get confused, but typically we have a segment in our live stream where we call it In Case You Missed It, and you have to sing the song. So can you go ahead and sing the song?
Me?
Yeah.
I don't know the song. What's the song?
Just sing the In Case You Missed It.
In Case You Missed It.
Yes!
Awesome.
Okay. So that's In Case You Missed It. And in fact, we've been having a lot of live streams recently, so we don't have too much that's new. Arlemy lets me know that our Canary build, which I think we've talked about before. Let's go ahead and I don't actually even know how to get directly to that page. It's postman.com/, I think, downloads. We do have a Canary build. So this is our download page. Feel free to download the app. But we have a early version. So if you want to get the jump on some new features, I think otherwise it won't be in production for another week or so. So you can get the jump on some new features. And so since we've had so many live streams, we've kind of covered a lot of the new features. So I did have one. Hi, Michael Bettendorf. Welcome. Welcome to the live stream. I did have one in case you missed it, and this is going to be, okay, so I'm going to go to this tab here. Look, that's your face. That's me.
That's my face. That's your face too.
Yeah. So I think, it was December last year. I'm going to go ahead and drop a link here if anybody wants to see what the old Postman office looked like and the Ping office in Austin looks like. It's a video that we made together. I don't know if I'm using this correctly, but there's a bit of cringe because marketing wrote the script for what we were going to say, and then we had to act it out, and it was a little watch it, and if you don't cringe, then we'll give you a cookie.
And but, make sure you tweet about hashtag Tacotarian. That's still my favorite. I laugh every time I hear that.
Tacotarian. Yeah. So if you don't know what that is, watch that video. It's just a little, and in fact, here's the title: to show you how to upload your API to the API network. So we were talking about this back in December. JW banning Oscar-worthy performances. Yeah. So acting's not Postman's wheelhouse, surprisingly.
Yeah.
But But it's kind of a funny little video where we talk about the API network. And in fact, we will work with the API network because as we were talking, when we were talking in Austin, and then while we were making this video, you did a ton of documentation for your company, and then you posted it to the API network. So I'm gonna consume it, critique it, and let you know. No, just kidding. I won't critique it, but we will be working with your APIs today.
Yeah, that's awesome. Yeah, thanks for your help for, you know, getting everything up and best practices and everything.
So let me go over back to our side-by-side view real quick. What are we doing today?
Today, we're going to look at the Pixie flow, specifically why you need to use it instead of the implicit flow in OAuth 2.0.
Okay, that was a lot of words. We have a bunch of folks that are in the chat. I'm hoping Kevin Swiber's watching because he's my go-to person at Postman to help me with like OAuth type things, like questions. We get a lot of, you know, OAuth 2.0 is used very commonly, as you already mentioned. We get a ton of questions about it where, you know, somebody's working with an API and they can't quite get something to work. So we're going to learn those actual flows. You know, Postman doesn't own those flows. Ping doesn't own those flows. They're standards, right? They're open standards. I don't know if that's the right word.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, and there are certain things that your company has built around those standards. And there's certain things that Postman has built around those standards. So we'll investigate like what is that general flow and then also like how to do it in Postman. Is that right?
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Yep.
Okay. All right. So I should probably share my screen. Let me go ahead and share my screen. Okay. So hopefully you see your face. Do you see your face here?
I see my face.
Okay. So I'm in Postman. And I did create a Ping account.
Let me close awesome. This. A free trial. Yeah, this is our Ping One for Customers admin console. So we have quite a few different products, and the Ping One for Customers is meant for the consumer use case. So people logging in to like order food or something or shop online, that's the kind of use case.
Okay, so if I'm making my own app, I'm an independent developer and I want to build off. This is why I'm here.
Exactly. Well, you don't have to build auth. This is kind of an alternative to doing it yourself, rolling your own authentication or authorization framework. So you can reach out to our IDaaS framework right here and get the services for the identity and authorization authentication stuff, not have to worry about writing that stuff yourself, complying with all these standards. We kind of handle all that for you and make sure it's real secure.
I have rolled my own before, and you have to own that data, that user data. You have to think about how you want to, like, what's the most secure. There's a lot of like trade-offs. And so it sounds like this product suite or whatever. Oh, you can't hear me? Can you hear me, Anthony?
I can hear you.
Wait, debased, do you mean you can't hear me at all or I'm very quiet? Oh, my gain is down. Let me know if you can hear me now. Oh my gosh, what if I've just been talking this whole time and no one can hear me besides you, Anthony? God. Okay, DeBase, let me know if me turning up the gain doesn't help out, but thank you very much for letting me know. So where should I start? Which flow are we starting with first?
So let's start with the implicit flow. We'll kind of do a compare and contrast there. That's kind of the old school way of doing things for a spa or a web app, something that lives in the front end. So first, we'll want to go to the connections tab at the top there.
Wait, so you were just talking about spa, single page apps and stuff like that. Like just really quickly for folks that are kind of new, like why is that like a sticky wicket?
Yeah, so maybe we should back up even a little bit further there. The OAuth 2.0 is an authorization framework, right? It grants people access to protected resources. So, and it does it in a secure way. And the kind of the overall flow that they came up with, actually, some of the people that came up with the OAuth work at Ping Identity, so it's kind of cool. I can Slack them, ask questions. But the overall flow was that you send an authorized request to the authorization server, and you'll get this auth code back. And later, you trade that auth code for a token, and that token is kind of the secret key to getting access to protected resources. The implicit flow kind of skips that middle step where you get the code, and then you trade that in for a token. Rather, you just go to the token endpoint and immediately get a token back. And the reason for that is spas are considered a public client, and that means that they cannot hold a secret securely, because the, you know, spas have all the code in the browser.
Yeah, so if I go to like postman.com and say we had like a big login screen here or something, you're saying that if I like inspect this, this is a weird interface. It's sideways. How do I make it go on the bottom?
It's a little three dots next to the settings tab.
You can see that I've never inspected anything on this Windows machine. Okay. And it's white too. Why isn't it dark? Well, okay. So what? Under network?
Under sources.
Oh, under sources.
Yeah. So this is all your source code right there. You can see everything. And if you were to have a secret in your app, it could show up right here. People could use that.
Okay. Secret in the app, or if the user inputs data and then like transforms it or uses it to kind of display something else, I can see it with my eyes, right?
Exactly. Yeah. Or if you had like a plugin installed or something, right? Those could be kind of peeking in and looking at that source code. So you want to be careful about that.
Okay. So not going on the Postman website.
Yeah.
Okay. So where should we start?
We should start at the connections tab at the top. We're going to create an application connection. This is how you talk to the Penguin for Customer Services.
Okay. So add application.
Add application.
Is this going to take a while?
No, it shouldn't. Okay. It shouldn't take long at all. So we'll do the single page app in the middle there.
Okay.
And configure that. There's a couple of config values that we'll need. Just give it a name here.
Should I call it like Twitch? Oops.
Yeah. Yeah, Twitch Implicit, maybe.
Oh, we're creating separate apps for these? Hi, Arlie. Yeah, let's do that. Welcome. Are you here to learn about OAuth 2.0? Because that's what we're doing. Redirect.
Okay. Yeah, so this is where the token will be sent after the user authenticates with the authorization server. So a lot of people use https://example.com. It's a kind of a free hosted website that people could use for testing and stuff like that. So this is where the token will be sent after the user authenticates.
Okay, so I don't need to have access or domain control over example.com, but it's just to kind of match it up to the other side?
Yeah, in production, you want it to be controlled by you because, like I said, this is where the token will be sent. So if someone else owns that website, you can be sending tokens to them, and they might be able to access that protected resource.
Yeah. So Arlami, I remember before a live stream that we had a few weeks ago, we were trying to get OAuth 2.0 working for an IoT thing that it was like 15 minutes before the live stream. And we were like, well, how do we do this? Okay, we got to enter into this browser. It returns a code, copy that code over. And I was like, surely, Arlami, this is stupid. Surely this isn't how you're supposed to be doing it. But I think that is how you're supposed to be doing it.
Well, that would, happen through your app, right? Your app would pull down the URL from the window or whatever.
Right. Okay. All right. So here I am on grant access to your applications.
Okay. So these ones we can, you can request certain scopes when you get an access token. And these are just the things that this application connection is allowed to give out.
Okay.
So you can see the P1 here stands for our platform, our Penguin platform. Those were, you create devices for a user wants to create an MFA device or something. But for now, we can just select the OpenID ones. So if you go to the filtered by and the all, you can change that to OpenID. Yep, right there. And let's just select all of those, add the plus sign.
Okay, so we do have a question in the chat. Ziad is asking, what is OAuth?
OAuth is an open standard for authorization. And specifically, we're talking about OAuth 2.0, the new and revamped version.
O is for open?
O is, that's a good question. I don't know what the O is for.
Okay, so I selected all four OpenID scopes so that we can control exactly what we're granting. Save?
Exactly, yep.
Okay.
And now we can select these mapping attributes that you get in the token. If you decode the token, you can see that the user ID will be mapped to the sub attribute. So we can just leave this as the default for now.
Save and close?
Yep.
Okay, and there we go. Published. Well, this is our app. We have like... Okay, this is a trial account, so don't worry about seeing my secrets. We plan to do that. We meant to show you, and we will be showing you more secrets.
Yes, and you can regenerate our secrets too from the admin console. So if you want to demo it out, then afterwards you can go regenerate that to get a fresh one.
Got it. Okay. So now what?
Okay. So now we're going to use our fancy little Postman collection.
Okay. Do we need to turn this on?
We do need to turn that on, yes.
Okay. Sarah Harak says, Google says OAuth is open authorization. So O is for open. Awesome. Thank you. Thanks for Googling that. And yes, Arlami is making fun of us. Arlami, we plan to share these credentials and we will show many more. So please don't give us chin beard. I don't.
We trust all of you guys to respect our secrets. So.
Okay. So now we're going to head over to Postman.
That's right. Yeah. We have a Postman collection that you can just download. It's uploaded to the API network and on our website. So.
Okay. So I'm going to go to new, tab over to API network and search for ping.
Yep. That'll work.
Oh yeah. You guys just published this recently, right?
That's right. Yeah. So we made a lot of updates and we made sure our docs and everything are really fully fleshed out. So
yeah, I saw it recently and it looked really good. So I slapped this little featured bit on there, but okay. You have a lot. Which one is it?
The top one there is the one that the first two are for ping one, but the second one has a little bit extra information about getting started guides and stuff. But if you just want the request that we're going to run is the top one there.
This one, platform APIs?
Correct. Yep.
Okay. These are called kind of the same thing. I don't know the difference, but I'm going to just... Oh, wait. I can view the documentation. Okay. I'm just going to pull this one in because you know what it is.
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So I imported a collection and an environment. Okay. So I'll go ahead and... What's it called? Ping? I have too many.
Ping one platform APIs. Okay. There we go.
There. I'll bring it to the top. And what was the... Ping this one?
Yes.
Okay. All right. So I have your, 262 requests, and we're going to go through them in order, right?
Actually, reverse alphabetical order.
Okay. Oh, okay. Let me just see what you have in your environment, because not everyone uses environments, and I'm just curious.
Yeah, we got quite a few variables in here, too.
Holy cow. Okay. That's a lot of stuff. Okay. Cool. Most of the values... For what we're doing. Okay.
Yeah.
Now what?
Now, so we're going to authenticate. You want to go to authentication APIs collection there and the OpenID Connect OAuth2 folder. Okay. An OpenID Connect is just the authentication framework that sits on top of OAuth. So you can get the authentication as well as authorization.
Is OpenID Connect like a ping thing or is that like an open standard?
It is an open standard, but Ping was on the board that created it too. So,
got it.
Yeah, it is an open standard.
Okay, cool.
The open here stands for open. We're going to go to the.
Okay.
We're going to go to the authorize implicit in parentheses there.
The get.
And we can do the get request. Yeah, so that trips people up sometimes. It's in the admin console. You can choose whether you want to post or get, but the default is get. So.
Okay. So we're getting a token, I'm guessing?
Yeah, the implicit flow, remember, is you're not getting that auth code in between, right? We're going directly for the token and skipping that middle step.
Okay.
So yeah, there's a couple environment variables we'll need here. That one should be filled out. Environment ID, that we'll need to switch back to our admin console and pull that one from there.
And should then, I make this side by side or is that like weird? Let's make it side by side.
Yeah.
I don't know if PC or if Windows has like a Windows manager. So I'm just going to drag everything like this. And then we need this thingy here. Oh, no, I'm covering your comments. Okay. Anthony, let me know if people are asking questions in the chat, please. Actually, I have it open over here.
Windows key plus arrow right.
Does what?
That's the Windows manager, apparently.
So maybe I'll click on this and go... Windows arrow. What?
Oh, cool. Thanks, Arlami.
What? Oh, look. Okay.
Oh, it's got like the full Mac thing.
This is Windows. Okay, wait. Where did you
go?
But, am I going? Okay, here it is. Okay. All right. Here we go.
Okay. Yes. So we're going to go to the settings tab at the top in the admin console, okay. And you'll find the environment ID there.
Here, I'm going to zoom out a little bit just so we can see a little more. Okay. So here's under the settings tab, environment ID.
Yeah. Yep. There we go. We'll put that into the environment variable in Postman.
Okay. Well, this looks terrible. How?
It's like hold on, back, hold on. But better, Anthony.
Where did the... I don't like this. I can't see any of the little icons. We're zoomed in too heavily as well.
Yeah.
Okay. Environment ID?
Correct. Yep. It's in the env ID.
This one? Okay. So yep. I'm in a team environment, and because I don't want Arlemy to come in and like steal all my credentials, even though he's on, I'm going to put it here. I'm going to put it in under this second column so that it's more secret.
Awesome. Okay,
we got environment ID. Now what else? App ID?
App ID, and that's going to be the client ID, and you can go back to the connections tab. Yeah, in their admin console. Oh, it moves both of them too.
Windows for the win. Application.
Select that little drop down there and configuration, or it's right here too in the client ID, the third one down.
This one?
Or that too. This one? Yep. It's all over the place.
Okay. So client ID is app ID?
Correct. Yep.
Okay. If I had to give you some feedback, I would recommend that you call it the same thing because sometimes it's confusing.
Yes. Absolutely. Yeah. That we need to make that update.
Okay. Now what? Okay. Will our request work?
I think our request will work now.
Update. Let's look at this a little bit bigger. Lots of params.
The one thing we don't have is the P1 read user parameter in the scope. We didn't remember when we select the grants, we didn't select any of those P1s. We just had the OpenID connect one. So if you want to delete that.
So I'll just deselect that one.
Just the P1 read user part.
Okay. This one.
Yeah.
Okay. And this is also because we did use this as our redirect URI. If I had put like postman.com, I would have had to update this, correct?
That's correct. Yeah. And that we're going to update with environment variable too. So make that a little easier. So we should be good to go.
Okay. Let's see. Is this correct?
So this is correct. It worked, but how OAuth works is that the client, oftentimes your browser for a spa, is going to send the authorized request to the authorization server, Ping1 for customers in this case. And then the authorization server is going to say, hey, send them to this login screen so that the user can authenticate. So that's what this screen is showing here. So we want to pull this URL into the browser. And I always do that by generating the code, the little feature that Postman has.
Okay, so this URL.
And then pulling the URL. Correct, okay, yeah.
So you're saying go to this code, Jen, and then get this whole thing?
That's right. Okay. And then we can plop that into a browser, and it should pop up the sign-in screen for us.
Okay, so I'm back in tiny browser. And then this is that URL. Hit enter?
Hit enter. Yay. Okay.
Is that what we wanted to happen?
So this is our sign-in screen. That's what we wanted to happen. Okay. Do you remember this user at all?
Antonic. I saw him. There was like a dummy sandbox database of users, and I remember Anton. Ick.
Okay. Antonic Sally Face. So if you want to go back, or if you had the password, you can just enter it here. After this, we'll be redirected to the example.com with our token.
Oh, no. Can I reset from the console?
Yep, you can reset from the console. It's up at the identities tab at the top.
Okay, so these are the fake people. This guy?
Yeah. And the reset password button at the top of the little box. Yep.
Can you tell me something that I'll remember?
You could do 4. And then theater with a capital T, and then some kind of like a question mark.
Really? Like I don't understand what you're saying.
The number 4.
Yeah.
And then Theater might be hard. Why do you think of theater? Well, look, table.
Okay.
With a capital T.
No, gosh, no. Okay, four table.
And then some kind of punctuation, a symbol.
Question mark.
Like question mark. Yeah.
Should I write this down?
Correct horse, batter, staple. That one's easy one to remember.
Will you remember it? I have no short-term memory.
Four table, question mark. Yeah, we got that.
God, I hate this. Okay. Cryptocoder. What? Todovsky says correct horse battery state. Well, no, because there's like, okay, forget it. Okay, we're doing this one. Please, everyone, remember this. Save?
Yes. Okay. Save.
Don't.
And now we can log in with back on the other screen.
Okay, it's four table
question mark. Yeah, because we reset the password from the admin console. We'll have to create a different one.
Can I do like four table exclamation?
Yeah.
Okay, four table. I feel.
Well, this one's your.
Okay.
Sorry. Yeah, the next two.
I should not do this on a live stream because people will be able to social engineer like my actual passwords. Okay, so four table exclamation point. Four table exclamation point. Okay, save.
Save.
Stop, Google. No one wants to do this. Okay. We're here at example.com.
That's the implicit flow. We're finished. So the access token you can see is in the URL right
that
there.
That whole thing?
And if we want that whole thing, yeah, there's going to be some extra stuff on the end. So you have to chop off a little bit, but you can highlight from there. Yeah. This is called a JOT.
Oh, this is a JSON web token?
That's right, yeah.
Okay, so should I end
it? So just before the...
There?
Oh. Yep.
I hope I did that correctly. Okay, now do I go back to Postman?
Well, I mean, so this is the implicit flow. If you wanted to look at different things, if you wanted to see what the access token looks like, we can do that in Postman. Or if you granted it scopes to P1 read user or something, you could read your user profile.
Okay.
And so... If you want to check that out, we can do the token introspection in Postman. Okay. Yeah, so go down to the token introspection access token. Yep.
Okay, post.
Yep, you have to put the access token in the authorization, I believe. No, this is app ID and app secret, so I don't think we added the app secret yet. We'll have to do that to the environment variable. And then the body, I think, is where the access token goes.
So the body takes...
Am I losing you, Joyce?
No.
You're too quiet.
I'm here. So you said the access token... I just have it saved to my clipboard, and I can only have one thing in my short-term memory at a time. So you said that for... To use this introspection endpoint, I need to submit the token in the body. So I'm going to go find this in the environment and plop it in there?
That's right. Okay. That's right.
So edit. Access token. Oh, it's right there. There's my JSON web token.
Yep.
Okay, update.
Yeah, well, we'll need the app secret too because we didn't fill that in earlier. So that is the client secret in the admin console.
Okay, so go to the – this is not users. It should be in connections.
Should be on connections. That's right. And then you open that, go to the configuration.
Okay. So this one? It's client secret?
Yep. You click the little eyeball there, copy it. Do it really quick, though, so no one sees.
It's a test account, we know. It's not like you can't go back and... Okay, so this is client secret, and we're going to put it in under app secret.
Yes, right.
App.
It is a long access token. That's how most of them are, and they look kind of jumbly too, Cryptocoder.
That's JSON web token for you. Isn't it like three parts or something?
It is three parts. Yeah, separated by a period and then base 64 URL encoded.
Do I need a client ID, app ID?
These are going to be in the authorization tab, actually, so you don't need to check those.
Oh, I don't need to check this?
Yeah.
Okay, you're saying AppSecret is going to take read it from...
Yeah, you can show password and it'll show the environment variable there.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
All right, so the difference between in Postman, at least the difference between manually adding headers here or doing it here is that it just generates it during runtime. So hit send.
Hit send, yep.
Request denied.
Unsupported authentication method. Okay, this is because, remember I was saying before, the get versus post thing. So we'll have to change in our back in our admin console, the token endpoint authentication method. And that's on this configuration tab. Yep, go back there. Scroll down a little bit so you can hit that pencil. Yeah, if you scroll down a little bit, it'll, yeah, the token endpoint authentication method with the three radio buttons. Yeah, we'll change that to post.
Post.
Or sorry, basic. We're doing a basic auth, so we'll want the basic.
Okay.
Yeah.
So save?
Hit save.
Yep. Do I need to get a new access token? That again.
No.
Okay, so we just enabled this type of auth. Woohoo! You fixed it. Okay.
I fixed it. There we go. Yeah, so this is just what the access token looks like inside. So you can see all the different things that's encoded in that long jumbled mess.
Oh, so you could decode the access token and be like, is it expired? Go get a new one, that kind of thing?
Exactly, yeah.
Okay.
Or if you want to see where it came from, the issuer, things like that. You can add different claims in here too if you wanted.
Claims?
Claims are what these little, the JSON values are called here. The active equals true, that's one claim.
Active equals true, okay.
Yeah. Okay.
All right, now... Is that the all we need to know about the implicit?
That's all we need to know.
Okay. What's the next flow we're going through?
The next flow is the authorization code flow, and we can do that with Pixie.
Wait, hold on. We have a question. I missed the step you did to fix the denied invalid type thing, Sarah Harak says.
Okay, yeah. That's so when we were sending that token introspection endpoints, we were using the basic auth header. And so we want to specify, I can't hear Joyce.
Still?
Someone else said
what's
that,
going
yeah.
on? BJ and Shaw, you know, do I sound weird or you just can't hear me at all? Oh no.
Someone else can hear you.
Okay, well, I'm sorry. I did fiddle with my audio settings before this live stream, but I'm sorry, I don't know what to do.
Do you know sign language? Can you do that too?
I am. Let's just keep going for now. So you were talking about this is the auth type we wanted for this endpoint?
Yeah, that's exactly. So in the configuration, we want to set the client secret basic in the admin console.
Okay.
And if we were using a post, if we were putting in the body, then we use the client secret post. So it just depends on what kind of requests you're sending.
Oh, I can fix my audio setting now. I remember where that was. Oh no, this is the worst. No one wants to watch me fumble around Windows, but hopefully you can at least understand what's going on. So we changed the token endpoint authentication method from none to basic because that's what we're sending in Postman right now. Okay, so
that's right.
That's implicit. And now you just said Pixie. Who's Pixie?
Pixie is an enhancement to the authorization code flow. Remember, I was talking about that overall basic flow that OAuth came up with and was designed around. They found out that on native apps, you know, things on your desktop or your phone, people can actually listen in on the response and steal that authorization code and use that to get an access token and then use that access token to get access to your resources. So you don't want that happening. We have to... Pixie is an enhancement that generates a secret that you can use. We'll walk through it some more, but basically it creates a secret, ties it to the auth code, and then that secret has to match that auth code when you send the token request.
Wait, I legit wrote an article about this not that long ago. Hold on.
Yeah. I got a video on it, too, that kind of goes over just how to visualize it.
Can you drop a link to that video in the chat?
Yeah.
I wrote this provocative blog post called Implicit Flow is Dead. Try Pixie instead because it rhymes. Let me go ahead and... We have some questions in the chat.
Okay.
Todofsky says, I always wondered what Pixie was for. Yeah, Pixie is the new standard, new recommendation. With a tablet, there's only one audio channel. Oh, today I learned. And Sarah Harak is asking, is this like a man in the middle?
It's different than a man in the middle because a man in the middle intercepts communication and then sends its own communication out. So it's a little bit different that just kind of it listens in. Basically, if your app is logging HTTP requests to the OS logs or something like that, then another app might be able to look at those OS logs, see that request, and pull out information from there.
Okay, so Pixie's for mobile, single-page app?
Native apps, they like to say. Okay. Yeah.
Is that the way? Okay.
Yeah, Wireshark could pull it, but you'd have to capture the network request there. So, but yeah, that's a good point.
Let's Pixie it.
Okay, so let's create our second app connection here for Pixie.
A new app?
A new app.
Okay, let me close this up.
So go back to the, yep.
Add app. Should we do native single again?
We should do native, yep. Let's do native. Okay.
This is Twitch native. I forgot how I wrote it last time.
Yeah.
Same thing here. Okay. Same scopes. Open night. Look at me learning. Wait, no, it's here. Sorry. Oh gosh.
Yeah.
Bragged too soon. Was there another one we wanted to add or no, just the open ID ones. Okay. So we're basically doing the same flow, but we're doing a different authorization. We're trying to accomplish the same thing, a different authorization flow.
Exactly. Yeah.
Okay. I didn't do anything on this one, right?
Correct.
Ooh. Okay. Native.
There we go. And we can toggle that little toggle on, guy. Turn it on.
Okay.
Yep. And then, so now we can, we're all set up to do our authorization code flow with Pixie through Postman.
Okay. So back to Postman. Where is it?
It is towards the top in this folder. Yeah. So we're using the basic, client secret basic. So we'll want to use the get request for authorize and then in parentheses authorization code. Yep.
But authorization code flow is different than Pixie is an enhancement on the authorization code flow.
Yes, that's right. And we have to actually configure that in our admin console. I forgot about that. So
back?
Yeah, go back to there in the configuration tab.
Oh my gosh, I'm like messing people's audio up at home like hardcore. I'm glad you can hear me now.
You just blew out his headphones.
Okay, so I'm here in the console under connections. Config?
Yes. So go to configuration tab. Yep. And we can edit.
Oh. Do I need to refresh this thing?
I think so. Yeah. First headphones go. now the app connection.
Okay. Native. Config.
Yep.
Okay.
Config. And we'll want to edit this guy.
Pencil.
Mm-hmm. So the Pixie enforcement, actually it's set to optional right now. We can leave it as that. We have, a couple different options here. You could set it to required, or you could require it to be SHA-256 encoded, encrypted.
I'm pouring my coffee, but I forgot to mention, if anybody in the chat has, I mean, people have been pretty good about questions, but also I know that there are a lot of authorization like experts or people that have built their own things. So feel free to chime in with your own experiences too. Okay, so leave it as, what do you want me to do?
Yeah, leave it as optional. Okay. Okay, and save this.
Okay.
Sorry, one more thing. The client secret basic, we'll need to pick that up.
Yeah, basic. That one?
Yes.
Okay. Okay.
That's exactly what it means.
Okay.
Okay, so we're good there.
Okay, back to Postman.
Go back to Postman. Yep. And so we should have our values filled out. Now we're going to add the Pixie parameters. And so we need a code challenge. And it should be underscore.
Where am I looking?
You're going to add a new parameter value.
Okay. So interestingly, like this all looks like super complicated to me, and it looks like nothing to you because this is your company. Well, not even your company, but you live in security. You live in auth. This looks like gibberish to me, but I'm going to show you how to do this in Postman a little bit easier. So Postman's my wheelhouse. Auth is your wheelhouse. And so we're going to see both ways to do it. Okay. So add a new param.
Yep. Code challenge.
Code underscore challenge.
Correct.
Okay.
And then the value here, we're going to have to generate a random string between 43 and 128 characters.
Okay, so table four tables. No, we're not going to manually do that. Let's go to
I just built this app actually, so we can I can send a link in the chat.
You want me to use your app instead of LastPass?
Yeah, I think it's a little bit clearer to see what's going on than LastPass, but that was a little hack that we did the other day. Yeah, so right now it's defaults to 128 characters, SHA-256. Let's just use plain for simplicity here. And we can change that down to...
You said 40
make it a little bit smaller. 43 to 128.
How about 55?
Sure.
Okay. Do I need to do anything here? That.
No, those are the output values.
Oh.
Yep.
So code challenge?
So the code challenge. Yep.
Okay.
Want to copy that and put that in.
Here? Or is there a thingy up here? Is there?
There's no environment variable right now.
Here, let's make one real quick. Code.
Okay, cool.
Let's make it camel case so we can tell the difference. Look at us being all secure. I forgot. Is this what it was? Code challenge.
Yeah.
Okay. Update. Close. Okay. Now it's reading in our new generated 55 character something. Code challenge. Okay.
Yeah. Random string. Okay. So we can also include the code challenge method, but it defaults to plain. And since we're using plain here, we don't have to include it.
Okay. We've already designated plane in the config, is what you're saying.
No. It defaults to plane if you don't put a code challenge method in. Yeah, so we can send this off. And, looks like you already got back to the example.com. But this is, my clumsy way of doing it. But I generate the code again.
So I go to code.
Get that URL.
Get the URL with... our code challenge and all the params. Go to a browser.
Yep. And then correct. Yeah. Probably open up an incognito or it might use your session.
I just learned how to open incognito. It's window shift N. Arlemy.
That's it's command shift N on Mac. So I think it's,
is it control?
It might be control shift N. Yeah.
Haha. Very nice. Okay. Enter.
Yep.
Unsupported response.
Ooh.
Oh my gosh.
So we're using...
Lua's the same person. Lua, you helped me on the other live stream with that incognito and I forgot it immediately. Thank you.
Oh. Yeah, so we can read this message a little bit more here. Unsupported response type.
Error.
Code.
Request failed. Unsupported response.
Yeah. So... can you figure this out, Joyce? Do you know what we need to change?
Don't make me look stupid, Anthony.
Sorry.
Let me read it. Read it. Unsupported response type. Unsupported response type. Code, something's going down there. Code. correlation.
That's just the error ID.
What's the issue?
If you go back to the admin console, and you go to the config tab of our application connection.
Yeah. We're under the config of our app.
Yeah. So the response types, you can see those selected there. Code is selected. Did we save this?
Where do I save it?
It should be at the bottom.
Am I zoomed in too hard?
I guess we did. No, we didn't edit it. So, yeah, it looks like we have code selected here. It should be an available response type. If you go back to the Postman request.
Aw, thanks, Lua. Lua says that we are teaching them things. We're teaching them how to debug awesome. This right now.
Yes.
Sorry, what are we looking at now?
Okay. So now the param response type, it says code there.
Okay.
Okay. And we have code selected in our config. That's odd. So maybe we need to unselect the other ones that aren't code so that we can just get the code one working in the admin console, sorry.
Got it. So token and ID token unselect. Wait, what's this? Oh.
Yeah, so that's the grant type.
Do we have Do we have that selected somewhere here?
Yeah.
So do we need to unselect this?
You can uncheck it. Okay. Yeah. So that's what the token ID token are tied to the implicit grant type. So we can save this.
It. Was it trying to do code response type but with implicit flow? Maybe.
Yeah, that might be what was happening here. It's kind of strange. It was doing that.
Should I hit send or do we want to look at this some more?
Let's look at it in the browser.
Like this thing?
Yeah. Okay.
I can't remember if we changed anything. We have a quote.
The Pixie enforcement set to optional just means that you can send the code challenge and code verify. You can use the Pixie enhancement to auth code flow, basically. Or you can require it. That's the other option. So it's add a little more security, right, to require the Pixie on top if you're using this on a native app.
Why?
Okay. So it's probably the code challenge. Maybe it's a dash instead of a underscore.
Okay. So in the param?
Yeah. No problem, Sarah.
Sarah Harak. I don't know.
Sarah Harak.
You think it's a dash, even though everything else is underscore?
Yeah, let's try that.
Okay. So go to code. I guess we could have just changed this in the URL.
Oh, it's Corey Harris backwards.
Corey Harris. So it is. It's like a taco cat.
That's clever.
Okay. So going back to my incognito like this.
Yeah.
No, surely nobody would inconsistently name a variable.
Yeah, that'd be crazy. Let's see. Oh.
Wait, is it this?
That's one thing. It shouldn't error out like that.
Okay.
You know what the problem is? We never switched our app ID value to use our new
app.
Switch native
okay.
app connection.
I understand. Okay.
That's why.
Okay, so we have this app ID that is identifying. How do you close this? I'm zoomed in too hard.
You can the top okay. yeah link. Yeah.
So it's pointing to Twitch implicit. We should point to Twitch native. So we should get the app ID, which is called client ID, right?
Correct.
So I'm going to go back over to Postman.
Which you always remind me of. So I'll definitely fix that for you.
It's confusing. And I mean, Postman answers so many like support questions for other people's APIs. And if you just call something the same thing, that helps greatly.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree.
What is this? App ID?
App ID.
I just lost my train of thought.
I forgot your train of thought. I can't change the subject here.
Do we need to change app secret too?
Yes.
Okay, so I'm going back here. Client.
Unless miraculously it was the same.
Is it client secret?
Yes. In our docs, we got a little table too that shows all the environment variables and what they mean. So if you get stuck, you can always reference that.
You were telling me about a little bug that Postman had, or not a bug, but like a little something. So we added this little return carriage symbol just to let people know, like, hey, you have a new line. And so I can squinch it up that way. But in the edit mode, I think you pointed out, like, you don't have that showing, and it's hard, really hard to see it.
The eyeball.
Yeah, yeah, like it doesn't up show here. If I had pasted it, if I had like pasted it here, you wouldn't see it very clearly. Yeah. So.
Yeah. But then I found in the code generated, it was showing that extra line there. Yeah. So.
Okay. That's how you debugged it. Wait, what am I doing now?
Yeah.
What's going on?
So we just changed the app ID and the app secret to match our new Twitch native app connection. So now this should work.
Are we using the secret?
Not here. We will later when we send the token request.
Should I delete this scope?
Yeah. It'll technically ignore it per the spec, the OAuth spec. But we should delete it. Just good practice.
Ooh, we're reporting more bugs. DeBase says, if you try to move environment variables, the interface becomes laggy. I wonder if they mean if I hit edit and like drag stuff maybe?
Yeah, I tried to alphabetize these, but it was kind of slow to move around.
Interesting. I haven't seen that. But, I mean, you have a lot of variables.
Yeah.
Okay, so I deleted that unnecessary scope, and then we updated the app ID. Is this where we take the code?
That's right.
Okay, so we get the URL.
That's right.
And, fifth time is the charm in our incognito browser.
Yep.
And then we... Okay. All right.
It worked.
Okay. So now do I put in here?
We can use Antonic again. Okay. Antonic.
So I'm going to go back to the ping console and go to identities.
Well, you don't remember the password that we had?
Well, I didn't know his username.
Oh, okay.
But...
Do you remember the password?
Don't do this to me, Anthony.
I'm sorry.
Where am I? Okay, so this is the username. Is this the table one? Yeah. For table? For?
Yeah, and then we change it to excellent. Exclamation.
Okay. Will it?
Maybe it's like gin and tonic.
What?
The name? That's how they came up with the name?
This?
Yeah.
Antonic.
Like a play on that.
Antonic.
Yeah.
Oh, that's clever. Okay, what are we doing? Oh, this is the code.
Okay, so we just logged in. We are redirected back to example.com with our authorization code. We're doing the auth code flow, right, with Pixie.
Okay, so we take this?
So, yeah, and just a little background. When the authorization server generates this code, it also matches it up to that code challenge that we sent, and then records that. Okay, so the next time when we send a token request, I explain a little bit more about why it does that. So take the code, yep, and we'll go back to Postman. And we can check out the token authorization code request.
Okay, so we just got this, we use this endpoint to get, actually we use this entire like URL to get this code. And now we go to post this one, token.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Is this also in the body?
And then, this is the auth code is in the body. Okay. Yep.
So we created this. We will. Here?
That's right. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. And this is our token request. We have to send the code verifier along with this since we're doing Pixie. Okay. So yeah, put that as another value in the body.
Verifier?
Verifier, yep. And we can go back to our tool and copy that value.
To where?
The tool that we use to generate the
This one?
Yeah. Yep. Our 55 character.
Code verifier. So last time we did code challenge and this time we're doing code verifier.
Exactly. Yep.
Oh, wait, let's parameterize it.
Oh, you use camel case for the code challenge.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Narc. Okay, so code verifier. Actually, that. Yep. Thank you, actually, for telling me that, because it is very frustrating when things aren't consistent and predictable. So, it's best practices. Yeah. Okay, is that it?
That is it. So the when you send this to the authorization server, Ping1 for customers, it's going to take that code verifier and the code challenge method, which is plain in our case, so it defaults to plain here, so we don't have to add it. It's going to take that, transform it with the method. With plain, it's not going to do anything to it. And it's going to check the authorization code that we send, see what the code challenge method or code challenge that it recorded earlier when we sent the authorize request, and see if those match up exactly.
Okay, so we're using Ping's like backend. They're saving that code. Sorry, what did you call it?
The code challenge.
And then
tied to that authorization code. So only that authorization code has that code challenge.
Is it kind of like a hash? And then you compare the hash afterwards. And then if it's okay.
Yeah, just a mapping.
Okay, cool, cool.
Yeah. And then now it gets the code verifier and the code challenge method. So it can transform that code verifier into a code challenge and then check that to see if it matches up with the earlier code challenge we sent.
Should I hit send?
You should.
You said the word code so many times, but I think that makes sense to me. It makes sense to me. Oh, invalid grant. Oh, wait, let's debug this. Let me move your head.
Yeah.
Code challenge.
Code fire. Now, see, this is actually good because this is exactly what I was trying to explain, right? The code verifier does not match code challenge included in the authorization request. So do those two values in our environment variables match up? The code challenge and the code verifier?
Oh, down here. Oh, I wonder if there's a... It looks the same to me.
Yeah.
Code challenge, camel.
You sent it. We sent that earlier in the authorize request. You tab over.
Is this the right one?
Yeah. Yeah, we sent that off.
Wait, is it this thing? Surely it's not dash.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's underscore this red.
Do we have to do it all over again?
Okay. Yeah, it's just putting it in the browser.
Okay, so muscle memory, maybe I'll learn it on my own one day. Go back to the incognito.
Yep. I definitely planned all these debug sessions into our live stream here. So
I think that's helpful.
Kudos.
Oh, it worked. Okay. Yeah. So we take the code.
Take the code.
Back to
add it to our environment variables.
Is it code verifier?
No, authorization code.
Oh, God. This one right here. Okay.
Yep. That correlation ID is an error, is the ID for the error message in our logs and our backend. So if you open a support ticket, we can see exactly or see part of
this one
when that request was sent, if there's any error. Yeah. Someone asked about that.
That's interesting. Okay. All right. Hit send.
Hit send.
Whoa, there it is. Access token.
Yes.
Okay.
We got it.
Is this JSON web token?
It is a JSON web token. You can actually
see the dot
in there.
Right there.
Is it that little line break? Yeah.
Yeah.
There should be another one in there somewhere too.
Yeah, because you said it's three parts.
It's the header, the payload, and the signature.
Oh, it's
I
right
actually
here.
have a
It's
tool
right
if you
here.
want to use. Oh, you found
Yeah.
it? You search for it.
Okay.
Yeah, I got another tool. It's a jot decoder if you want to look
Yeah,
inside.
drop a link to it. We can. Well, I want to show you. So, okay, we have a little bit of time. We did good, Anthony. We have a little
Yeah.
bit of time. I want to show you like a different way to do this in Postman. Should I take a look
Absolutely.
at
I
this?
don't want to jump back and forth between the browser and everything.
I think it really helps to walk through every step. Should I paste this here?
Yeah.
What is the ID token?
Yeah, the ID token is part of the OpenID Connect standard, and that's going to have information about the user that authenticated. So the Mr. Antonic, Gin and Tonic, when he authenticated, there'll be some information in there. So we can pass that between different apps, so they can have some information in there about that user.
So Anthony, I just copied this to my clipboard, the whole access token, all three bits. Where do I put that?
Paste in the top line here, and then I'll hit the code, the jot, the
Oh,
top
so
line.
this whole thing is a JSON web token, and that's going to break it down into the two pieces.
Yeah, there's a signature in there too, but for security reasons, I didn't decode that because you need to upload a key and decrypt that. So for security reasons, yeah, I don't want you uploading
Ooh, it's like
keys.
magic.
Yeah, and it looks just like our token introspection endpoint, if you remember us doing that from the implicit flow.
Is it still
If you
open?
still have that tab open, yeah.
This one?
Yeah, it looks just like
Yeah.
that. Yep, that's the payload.
Okay, I feel like there could be a whole nother session on like just JSON web tokens and stuff, but okay, we're doing really, really good. Is there anything else you wanted to show us, like by stepping through some API calls?
No, I think that's it. We can put the token introspection with the ID token if they want to take a look at that.
CryptoCoder is asking, so this token is sent on every web request?
Every request to our PingOne for Customers API.
Wait, which token are we talking about now? The ID token still?
Oh, the access token, sorry. The ID token, yeah, you can pass that around to your app, which it would pull down from the URL. That's how we got it, right? Or if it sent a request just through some API library. And then you could decode that and use that for the information about the user.
Oh, and this one has like it expires in what's this? How much
An
an
hour.
hour? Okay. And it's bearer token
Yeah.
type. Okay. So like in Postman, if you wanted to send bearer tokens, you can like copy this to your clipboard. You can like generate this, you can copy it to your clipboard, and then you could open up a new request and be like, bearer token, go ahead and plop it in there. Or you could be like, what would be the header? Is it just like token? And then you would like
Yeah.
plop, you would paste it here. So there's a couple of ways to use that access token now, depending on your API that you're working with.
Yeah, exactly. And the access token, based on what scopes we ask for and what grant types or grants it has, the application connection has, that limits what that access token is allowed to do, right? So if you send a request and you don't have the appropriate scopes, then the API won't send you a response back, or it'll send you like an error response back,
Yeah.
right? Insufficient
Yeah.
permissions.
That's something that like a lot of times it's easier to just like grant all the scopes, but then it's like, do you really need it? Like it's not security best
Yes.
practice.
Exactly, yeah.
Okay. So we have actually used this. Where did we use it? Here, right? On this request, we use the basic authorization helper.
Yeah, we put it in the body, I
Oh,
believe, the
that's
access
right. Yeah.
token.
Okay. We used this one,
Yeah.
but let's. I'm going to show you how to do like Pixie in one of the auth helpers. Which request should I replicate?
So yeah, so let's go to the management APIs
Okay,
collection.
so we've been playing around in the authentication because we're trying to take the steps to get our auth token, but now we're going to management APIs. Holy cow, you have a lot of folders. This is great.
Yes, this is all our API stuff that we can do, basically. So the one that's might be easiest is the, let's see here, users.
This one?
Yeah.
Okay.
And then users again. Yeah, so we can read one user. We'll have to get well, if we want to do it with our access token we currently have, we'll have to add the scope to read user, P1 read user. Yeah, but you can show us how to do that in the auth header helper.
Let's add the scope.
The scope? Okay, yeah, we can do that. Yeah, go back to the authorize request. With a start that pixie flow over again. We have everything laid out, so it should be really easy.
Okay, where do I go to add the scope? Is it under my...
No, it's just in Postman when you send the... Oh, sorry. Yeah, we have to add the grant to that application connection.
This one?
Yep, and then it'll be access tab. Yep.
Pencil.
You can add that there.
Yep. Is it like, what's it called?
And then P1 colon read colon user.
This one? Okay, so in order for us to use that endpoint, because we were so restrictive intentionally with our scopes, we're just adding one more scope so that the endpoint works. Save it.
Mm-hmm. Save it.
Is that all we need to do to just add one scope?
Yep. And then when we request that access token, we'll just need to ask for that scope as well.
Okay. So.
So when we do the pixie flow.
Okay. So back in Postman, this one, we can use the pixie authorization flow to get this information.
if you wanted to do it the old way,
let's do it the new way.
The new way. Yeah. Then you can do it all right here with this request.
Okay. So it looks like we still need user ID. So is that gin and tonic?
Gin and tonic. You can go to the API tab.
Are these real people? Like, is it disrespectful to make a pun about this person's name?
I'm not sure. Sorry, Antonic. Antonic.
So should I go here and get this person's ID?
Yes. Okay.
ID.
So the API tab.
User ID?
User ID.
Okay. Is that the only one I need?
Yes.
Okay.
We have all the other ones filled
out. I'm going to look for user ID in here. User ID right here. Update. Close. And now we're trying to get... is this his first name? Antonic? Okay. Yeah. Antonic's information. And we need an access token, right? I should have practiced this beforehand. I don't actually know how to do this, but hopefully you know enough and I know enough and our viewers know enough that they can help us. So bearer token.
Yes.
We're doing OAuth 2.0, correct?
Correct. Okay.
So I have an access token with a header prefix bearer. If I click get new access token, I see this familiar modal. Anybody that's tried to do OAuth 2 in Postman has seen this and been like, what do I put here? Okay, so I can name my token. There's a few grant types. So we already walk through implicit flow and we walk through manually authorization code with Pixie, right?
That's
okay,
right.
So let's... do Pixie, because that's what's been enabled on our app, correct?
It is optional, so we can do it. Yeah.
What other one could we do?
We could just do authorization code without Pixie.
Let's do the Pixie.
Yeah.
The callback URL is whatever we added during our app setup. So that was HTTPS example, right?
Yep. That's right.
And then... this information, I think I have tried this once before, but where do I get this information?
Yeah, that's on the connections tab and then under the configuration of the app connection.
Okay, so I'm looking for op URL and access token URL. Connections.
Yep.
Here? Native.
Yep. And then configuration.
Okay, so auth URL is this one, ending in slash authorize.
Yep.
And then the...
You just want the... You don't want the, like, title part.
Oh.
You highlighted okay, a little too much. Yeah.
I was just reading it, but...
You can just double-click.
Okay. Look, so I'm going to make sure I have the right one there. And there's a carriage, so just delete that. Access token URL is... This one? Token?
The token endpoint, yep. Okay.
Look, I double-clicked in it, just like you said.
Nice.
Okay, oops. Okay. Code challenge method, you said default is plain, and that's what we did, right?
Mm-hmm.
Plain?
Yeah, and since it's optional, you could use either. We just have to tell the authorization server which one we're using.
Okay.
The SHA-256 is more secure because that transformation method is going to encrypt that. So if someone does steal the one of those code challenge or code verifier, then they don't know the other
one. The SHA one's extra hashy?
Extra hashy. Salted.
Okay.
Salted.
Oh, it's salted? Nice.
Yeah.
Okay. And so code verifier, do we need to generate a new thingy or can we use our old?
We can use our old. It's obviously best practice to use a new one each time. There should be one time use.
Okay.
So,
but that it's not enforced that way.
No.
Okay. So I think it's code verifier, if I'm not mistaken, camel case.
That's right.
Okay. Client ID. Is that app ID?
App ID. Yep.
App ID. And I could wait. Is it probably this? Wait, let's see.
No, it's big. It's okay. Two capital ID. Okay. Yeah.
So I'm just using curly braces to access the environment variables that we've already initialized, but clearly you could hard paste your credentials in here. And then client secret is app secret?
Yep. That's a good point, debased. Since the output is 64 characters long, you can kind of standardize the length of the code challenge.
Is SHA-256 also used to standardize? Okay.
So if you go back to the tool, you can play around with the code challenge method.
Wait, this one?
That one, yep. And if you change the slider, no matter what you change it to, the code challenge down there is always 64. So you can generate a new one and check it.
Oh, this one.
Yeah, so you can put it all the way down to 43 and it'll still come out 64 characters.
DeBase is saying this particular code challenge method standardizes the length of this one.
Okay, yeah.
Cool. Wait, what are we doing?
We're doing the...
Okay, scope?
Yeah, Pixie. Yeah.
Are these the right scopes?
Yeah, that's the OpenID one and then the read user one that we need for this particular request.
Okay. State?
State is not necessary. It's used for cross-site request forgery, which is an entirely different episode.
CSERF?
Yeah, so CSERF?
Okay. And then...
Yeah, so we don't need it here. It's optional.
Okay. And then client authentication?
Yeah, that's the difference between the client secret basic and the client secret post. So since we have basic selected, we want to use the basic auth header.
Yeah, basic. I remember. Okay, so request token. I really hope this works. What's this? Oh, no. Okay, so I'm in a little posted thing. And is this that gentleman's Antonix username?
Okay. Yes. Yep.
Oh.
Or, I mean, it could be anybody in there. But
where did it go? How do I see all my windows on Windows?
Is it command down or Windows down or up?
Oh, there it is. Okay, so I just lost track of this window. Whoa, it's very big. Okay, hold on. Well, I'll just put it here. Okay, and then the password? Is that the four table?
Four table, okay, yep.
Four table exclamation.
Yes.
Sign on. Ooh, yep. Okay.
Or four.
It worked. Awesome. It was the right one. So let me move your head. What Postman is doing is they're instead of entering some of that stuff into a browser to generate a code and then using another API call, you put a whole bunch of information in that little modal and it's generating your access token here. So I'm going to call this access token ping one. Let me call it ping one. I feel like I might have already generated one, so I'm just trying to differentiate. Should I just call it ping one two?
Yeah.
Ping one two. I'm going to generate a token name with this value. And is this that JSON web token? Yeah, you can see the dots.
Yep.
Okay. And it's bearer type. Here's all that information that we saw earlier in the response. And so if I go ahead and say use token, it pokes it in here.
Ooh.
Yeah. So, I mean, like, I guess we went down from two requests to one.
Yeah, but we also, I was jumping back and forth between the browser to like sign in there and then like come back and copy this value. Yeah. So this is much smoother.
So I have this here, but I can also like, you know, it's hard coded here. We can also variabilize it and that kind of thing. And then if we wanted to be like a different authorization flow, I don't know why I said it like that, a different authorization flow, we could then like generate an authorization code for ping one, you know? And call it like maybe authorization or some clever like that.
Yeah. Or if it expires, you want to go through this again, you can do that.
Yeah. So I have seen some people, it's kind of interesting. So you're saying that you can see the expiration from the access token information when you decode it, correct?
Correct.
Okay. So in a pre-request script, you could then just look at that token. Ooh. And if it's expired,
okay,
then you can trigger how do you do a comment? Is it control? Yeah, there it is. Okay. Check expiration of token, and then you can
cool.
Go get new token or a refresh token or whatever.
Yeah. Well, awesome.
That's all I had to show you in Postman. It was
that's
just
cool.
The modal.
No, thank you.
Yeah.
Streamlines my flow.
Yeah. And it gets a little confusing because like, if you don't call, like, what do you call the access token URL? Sometimes people don't know what the callback URL is, right?
Or we use redirect URI.
Yeah. Yeah. So in your dashboard, it's called redirect URI. In Postman, it's called callback URL. Yeah. It has to be exactly the same. So if I go www here, it like won't work.
Exactly. Yeah.
Okay, well, I didn't have anything else to show everyone. Does anybody want us to show anything while we still have you here on the live stream? Or, Anthony, is there special stuff that you wanted to show us about Ping that you're excited about that's coming up? Go ahead and ask your questions in the chat, and then, Anthony, you can...
Yeah. If you go to the settings tab in the admin console, and then all the way on the left... On the bottom, the authentication drop down.
The thumbprint.
If you pop that open. Yeah. And then click on policies. These are the sign on policies. So with Mr. Antonik, we were just using his username and password. If we wanted to do multi-factor authentication, we could assign this sign on policy to our application connection. So now that application connection will require people to go through a multi-factor authentication method.
MFA is the bane of my existence, but you guys have that flow kind of smoothed out.
Yeah. So it's, you could do push notifications or email or text, and you could customize the message and everything. And the required one is a cool option that, you know, we have some other options too, but if they haven't signed on in over an hour, then they'll prompt for MFA. If it's within an hour, then they won't get that MFA step.
Yeah.
So it's sort of dynamic, and I think that's really cool. You can set off an attribute value too. If they have a certain attribute value, then it can trigger MFA.
Rizal Farki says, grimace face. Not sure if they're grimacing at the MFA like I am inside. What else? Everyone in the chat, I feel like people had a lot of questions when we manually walk through. And then the abstracted auth helper and postman, people are like chirping crickets. So I don't know if that was just too much for everyone's brain and they're just like melting through their seats, or if it was just like, yeah, that's like how I did it before.
Yeah. Well, I think we walked through the hard part of explaining it first, right? So,
and I
the explanation wasn't required.
That helps me because, like, knowing the back and forth and knowing that in this case, I'm using Ping's service, Ping's keeping track of that. And that's what you don't have to roll on your own, is what you're saying, right?
Exactly. That authorization server part, you don't have to create your own authorization server.
Yeah. And then if I am building my own app, like either like my single page app, oops, I'm on the wrong page. If I'm like building my own single page application, or I'm building my own like native app, then I could just fiddle with it here, generate it, and still use the code to replicate the front end calls that I would be making to my ping server, right?
Exactly. Yeah.
Okay. Well, I don't have much else. If there aren't any more questions from the chat, let me go ahead and change to side by side really quick. Where is side by side discussion? So we like to end. Thank you so much for coming on this. I actually, this was a lot less nerve-wracking than I thought it would be.
Thanks for having me.
We usually like to end the sessions by sharing some shout outs for the community. And, you know, it just, if there's certain people that you want to give a shout out to, or somebody's built something, do you have anything that you want to highlight from the Ping community?
The Ping community,
or the security, like what's going on in security? Are there any events coming up? Does Ping, oh, I have a shout out to give if you don't have one, but go ahead. You first.
No, I didn't have any. Yeah. Just keep it up posting. And we have our own community forum on that developer.ping.net site. So questions keep coming in, and it's been really good for, my own knowledge and seeing what people are doing and everything.
Yeah, you should drop a link to that forum in the chat here. One thing I wanted to call out, which can't believe you didn't remember this, Anthony, but you and joke? Me, no, the joke was the Tacotarian. We had some people join, so I'm going to drop a link to this cringe video. Where is that? Here it is. This is the... If anybody wants to see the old Postman office and the current, I'm guessing, Ping office, we put together a video at the end of last year that just highlights some easy ways to do things and hard ways to do things. One call out I did want to say that we do have coming up is, and I don't have the exact date in front of me right now, maybe you'll know it, but you and I are actually going to be doing a webinar with some of the other Ping folks coming up soon.
That's right.
Do we know the...
Yeah, that's the first week of September. I believe it's that Wednesday. So, going over some cool stuff about how Ping used Postman to kind of go from development all the way to our customers.
Yeah, and it's kind of interesting. It's one of the first webinars. Our webinars typically get a lot of interest. And just to hear how a very large established company has done some things, I think we're going to have a really interesting QA story to tell, as well as the documentation. And Anthony, we just used... I don't have it up anymore, but... we'll drop a link to your documentation, because that was a lot. That was not insignificant. You have 262 requests in there. We're able to explore your management APIs when we got Antonick's information, and we got to use your authentication APIs where you, if you're rolling your own flow, you can understand what's happening, step by step. Or if you're using an auth helper in Postman, it just makes it a little bit easier to copy and paste some values and then poke send and be like, here it is. Here's my auth token.
Yeah. Like you said, for our internal testing and development, we use Postman all the time for that. So super easy.
Yeah. So that's all I have. If you don't have anything else, I think we'll just part ways until we meet again. Anthony, thank you so much for being on this live stream, and I hope to chat with you soon.
I hope for a part two of our cringy video series.
Okay.
So we'll get working on that.
Okay, sounds good. Okay, I'll talk to you soon. Bye.
All right, bye.